Good morning. May I have your attention, please? Would you please take a seat? And we'll get started. Please have a seat so that we can get started. Thank you. Good morning. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I want to welcome all of you to our press conference today. Thank you for coming. I know some of you came from various parts of the state, and I'm glad to see you here. I would like to share with you the Red Book, which is a citizen's guide to open government, which includes the Georgia Open Meetings Act and the Georgia Open Records Act. These books are put out by the Attorney General's office. They are free. They're on a stand over here. And I just wanted to share a little sunshine with you today. Following, there will be three speakers. The first, Garland Favorito. The second, Jack Staver. And the third, Catherine Bernard. They will discuss the following bills: House Bill 310, Senate Bill 94, and House Bill 430, which was attached to Senate Bill 94. And we will also be circulating a petition to the governor that you're welcome to sign. And then at the end of the press conference, we will deliver these petitions to the governor's office. And we invite you to join us as we walk to his office. Again, thank you for being here. And we welcome Garland Favorito.
I would be remiss if I didn't at least start by recognizing Nydia Tisdale, first of all, for the conference today.
The mic.
Can't hear you.
Okay. First of all, for the conference today that she has set up, I want to thank, is this better?
No.
Okay. So I want to thank Nydia for the conference, setting this up today, as well as all the work she's done to preserve our right to record in the state of Georgia. Thank you so much, Nydia, for all that work on record. This is also being filmed today by the famous Nydia Tisdale's camera that Dawson County deputies are very famous. And I think it probably will not have a gap on it today as it did when she got it back from the Dawson County deputies. So thanks again, Nydia, for all this. Today, as you know, is April Fool's Day. Every day is April Fool's Day down here under the Gold Dome, as we found out. One of the main reasons we are here, because I think all of us pretty much agree that this has been the greatest legislative assault on personal liberty and economic freedom that we have ever seen in a single session.
Yes.
It is absolutely amazing.
Here, here.
Expanded government, huge tax increases, new police state power. We want to go through some of the tricks that are being played on the people so that we end up with the opposite of what we actually thought we were going to get in some of these bills. There's tricks, there's bait and switch, there's false information, so on. So I'm going to go through three bills really quickly, as fast as I possibly can, just to give you the background of what's been happening down here. So the first one was what we call the triple no-knocks. These were three separate bills that proposed to legalize no-knock search warrants in the code for the first time in Georgia history. And it was kind of a bizarre concept as to how all three of these bills came to play. The logic was that we have to legalize no-knock search warrants in order to reduce them. Well, only under the Gold Dome would you hear that kind of logic that is exactly opposite from what the truth is. If you legalize something, I think we all know it's going to increase the use of it. It's not going to decrease the use. Only under the Gold Dome would you hear these kinds of ridiculous claims. In fact, these bills that were introduced, three of them, condoned the very practice that resulted in the murder of David Hooks in Dublin and the maiming of Baby Boo Boo up in Habersham County. The end result of all these three bills was not to protect against future murders like the one in David Hooks or the maiming of Baby Boo Boo. It was to absolve law enforcement from any criminal liability from the illegal acts that occurred in these illegal no-knock raids. Now, if the legislature was really concerned about minimizing no-knocks, they could have added penal statutes to the bills for anybody who executes an illegal warrant. They could have defined the verbal notice of intent and the length and audibility that you have to give. They could have made the evidence inadmissible in a court of law. Or they could have had the officer and the judge go before a grand jury to explain why they issued an illegal warrant in the first place. If they were really serious about stopping illegal no-knock search warrants in Georgia, that is what they would have done. Instead, they chose to legalize it. But that didn't answer the question. The question we had was, why did three different bills be introduced? How could they have been introduced with the same language? Is there some kind of clairvoyance going on between the legislators? How could all three of these sponsors come up with the same bizarre concept and the same bizarre language? Well, we did a little research and we found out that all three of those bills were written by the prosecuting attorney's counsel, specifically Chuck Spahos. He was behind those three. You've probably seen our news article up on Voter GA to explain exactly what happened. Those bills are now dead for this session. Thanks to you out there. We greatly appreciate your help on those. But they'll be back next year. But we'll be ready with new legislation. We'll have a real bill for the next year. Now, the next one I want to talk about is what we call the Rich Slick Trick. This was named after the chairman of the non-civil judiciary committee in the House, Rich Goer. It's so complicated that we had to have a diagram to explain what happened. SB 94 started out as a simple bill to just provide witness identification procedures, suspect identification procedures, and prevent witness coaching, that sort of thing. It passed the Senate unanimously, and when it went to the House, it goes to the House Non-Civil Judiciary Committee. Chairman Rich Golick decided to attach the entire House Bill 430 to Senate Bill 94, which has nothing to do with witness identification or suspect identification. But House Bill 430 has a lot to do with the civil liberties of the people of Georgia. Basically, it enables law enforcement to obtain secret search warrants and secret seizures of property. It extends probable cause to search for crimes that are about to be committed, not crimes that have been committed or are being committed. It allows non-certified personnel to apply for or issue a search warrant. It has all sorts of things that limit a defendant's ability to contest an illegal search. It gives the government the right of appeal of an illegal search after they've been convicted of it. It allows law enforcement to video record inside your property without your consent through body cams. And it even allows remote surveillance from someone to decide to surveil your house or your property or you without the consent of your local authorities. This bill and the previous bills were actually being supported by the ACLU, despite the fact that they are a severe threat to the civil liberties of every single person in the state of Georgia. In addition, HB 430 and the substitute for Senate Bill 94 was being supported by the Georgia Association for Criminal Defense Lawyers. We have been pressuring them, again, thanks to you, to ask them, why are you behind those bills? So, what this tricky thing does, this attachment, is it eliminates the need for the bill to go through the other committee to be vetted. So when you attach a bill in the House the way Rich Gulick did, it goes over to the Senate, and the Senate doesn't get to hear that bill in committee. They have to vote up or down on the floor if the sponsor was amenable to the attachment. Now, the original sponsor of this bill, Charlie Bechtel, said he was amenable, but I think he had no idea what Rich Gulick was going to attach on that bill. I've never asked him, but I think it's pretty obvious. A chairman has no business attaching two totally different bills together like this and trying to ramrod them through the legislature without a proper vetting process. I consider that to be unethical, and I think that's a practice that needs to stop. In addition, it disguises, House Bill 430 now is disguised as Senate Bill 94. If you look at the first read or something, it's not there. It doesn't say anything about what House Bill 430 does. So, who wrote this? House Bill 430 was carried by Chuck Estration, who was a former DA to Danny Porter out in Gwinnett County. But Chuck Estration didn't write the bill. The bill was written by Danny Porter of the Prosecuting Attorney's Council, as we found out. He, in fact, is the chair of that council. Chuck Spales is the executive director. These are the people, and this is the organization, that is behind the assault on the freedom of the people of Georgia. This needs to stop. The last one I would like to tell you about is what we call the Big Bro Bill. This is our big brother bill of government expansion, which is almost beyond belief. I don't think we can blame this one on the Prosecuting Attorney's Council because this one came right out of the governor's office. This bill has a massive government expansion with new police powers. It's unnecessary to achieve the reforms that are in the bill. The reforms that were in the bill got hijacked by this massive police power and expansion of government. It calls for this new Department of Community Supervision that is not required for any of the reforms that are in the bill. That community of supervision, that department and the commission that the governor appoints can have authority to set up an unlimited number of units and an unlimited number of employees. I'm just going to read you one sentence for the sake of time. It says, the commissioner shall have the authority to employ as many individuals as he or she deems necessary for the administration of DCS and the discharge of the duties of his or her office. Now, unlimited government. Not limited, not even expanded, unlimited. It gets worse. This allows the commissioner to confer full police powers on any or all of the department's employees, full police powers. And it allows the police powers to be used to assist law enforcement in maintaining the peace. This is all on page 6 and 7 of the bill. It also allows the DCS to set up a pretrial release program to impose sanctions against individuals who have not been convicted of a crime. Now, envision this scenario with what we have just heard and what we've just read and what's in the bill. Let's say that we decide that we want to protest the governor's policies over here in Liberty Plaza because the governor has been running on a platform of limited government, and yet the bills that he's putting through the legislature expand the government beyond belief and give him new police powers. We decide to have a protest over in Liberty Plaza. Well, the governor can use his new police force, either this governor or any other governor, can use his new police force to come out and make a call and say, hey, we'll take care of the peace effort over there. They go over, they arrest us, take us down, and put us in the new pretrial release program, which in turn the governor's office can impose sanctions on the protesters in pretrial release without any of us ever being convicted of any crime. Does that sound like America to you or Georgia?
Can you repeat that? That is so powerful.
Yes. So the governor, I was asked to repeat that one more time. The governor, if we were to go over and protest in Liberty Plaza, the governor's policies, which are, because he's running on a platform of limited government, but it's giving us massive expansion government. We go over, the governor makes a phone call and says, well, I want to use my new police power, I'll help you out to maintain the peace over there in Liberty Plaza. He sends his police unit over, they can cause an incident or cause us to be arrested. We will then go to a pretrial release program, which is stated on page 11 of the bill, and the governor's office can impose sanctions on us before we've ever been convicted of any crime. Now, that is really, really, really bizarre. So this bill, how did this bill get passed? Well, we went to the House Judiciary Committee, same committee, Rick Ciccola. Catherine Bernard was there. She explained all the problems that I just told you to the committee. She was totally ignored. Not one concern that she raised was actually incorporated into the bill or even considered for incorporation. So the bill was simply, basically, as we came back over to the Senate, it passed the House, passed that committee, came back over to the Senate, we had the famous, what is now the famous Senate Public Safety Committee hearing, in which the bill sponsor, Alan Powell, stood up and said, this bill was simply an unplugging and replugging of criminal defense functions. Well, I've just explained to you that that's a false statement. He said that there were no new police powers granted. I just explained to you that that's a false statement. He said that no issues were raised in the House hearing. I just explained to you that that's a false statement. And then he claimed that the recent new opposition was suffering from paranoia. So, Catherine Bernard, when she got up, and I hope you'd see this, this testimony, Catherine went point for point down here and told the committee that this bill was presented untruthfully to the committee, repeatedly. I got up and I corroborated Catherine's testimony. At that point, there was so much opposition testimony that I had to schedule another hearing with not all of the senators present. That was later in the afternoon. The committee went on to pass the bill. It was passed, and when it went to the Senate floor for a vote, only two of the seven senators on the Public Safety Committee could hold their nose long enough to vote for this bill on the floor of the Senate. 20 senators did not vote for the bill. And only three had the courage to vote against it. Now, this bill is now on its way to the governor's desk. And it has no fiscal note on it for expenditures. No fiscal note. Anybody know why? You can't put a fiscal note on infinity. This is an infinite expansion of the government. If they had quantified it, they could put a fiscal note on it. But if you've got unlimited expansion, what can you do? So we mentioned some of the stuff to the senators in the committee. They said, well, we'll control this through appropriations. We said, how are you going to control this through appropriations in the future? How are you going to have the courage to stand up to the governor then when you don't have the spine or the backbone to stand up to it now and you've got total public support behind you? It'll never happen. We're on the verge of unlimited government and police powers, and Big Brother is going to be watching you very, very soon unless we do something about this. I want to turn it over to the next speaker. I think Jack Staver. Jack, come on up. He's got a plan on something that we might be able to do. And Jack is something, he's been working with him for a long time. A real person that we're going to get in for North Carolina.
I think you can hear me. Everybody can hear me?
No.
No,
speak into the mic.
I'll speak into the mic. I project pretty well, but I guess not today. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for taking the time out of your day to come down here, which you shouldn't have to do, but we have to do this. Isn't it sad that it's come to this point that we can't let the cats out of the cage? We have to keep them in and watch what they're doing because they're killing us? Well, right now, I want to speak to you as a matter of grave concern to all Georgians, in fact, all Americans. We, as a Republican majority in the House and Senate, should espouse the Republican principles which are at its core smaller government, which includes less government involvement, reduced government spending, and lower taxes. It appears that our alleged Republican majority didn't get the memo, and we're in a course of expanded government and higher taxes that will be unsustainable. One of the biggest problems is leadership, or should I say, lack of leadership. Our legislators have increased the size and scope of government whilst not even wincing at we the people who have testified in hearings, called, faxed, emailed, spoke to them in person, talked to them in town halls, only to fall on deaf ears. We the people are being ignored by an elite class of legislators that are about me, the legislator, rather than we the people. Where do we go from here? Well, to quote our current governor, this is an article, I have the backup for the article, I'd be happy to give anybody a copy of that. Governor Deal said that government needs to shrink to reflect an economy that has left nearly 10% of residents unemployed, driven down tax revenue. Republican rhetoric has a great opportunity to be put into practice, Deal said. We believe in smaller government and less spending. Guess what? We got lower revenue, there's going to be smaller spending. And when you have less spending, you're going to have smaller government. These are the realities of the world in which we live. End quote.
When did he say this?
I have the copies. This was in September, I believe, of 2010. So this is campaign promises. This is everything. There's more. I just pulled this one out real quick because if you ran on it, that's what you stand on. And if we have a Republican majority here, we need to act like it. We're not doing that. So in closing, I'm going to ask our governor to listen to we the people who put you in office, to stand by your promises, as I just mentioned, and veto HB 310. This is the people's house. Listen to us. When I got wind at midnight that they passed the billion-dollar transportation tax, which we didn't have an opportunity to listen to vote on this time, and they did this by design because, again, it's about me, the legislator, not we, the people. So I stayed awake most of the night, and all these things have run through my head, but I am tired of having to come down here and have us talk to so-called Republicans, and they won't do anything. They don't listen to us. They've elevated themselves to something that they're not. And it's time that we don't take this anymore. We have to stand down here. We call them, we visit them, we continue to do this. But better yet, let's talk about primarying all these folks down here because they're not listening. So it's time to start now. With that, I'd like to introduce a real freedom fighter who's really been digging into this a lot, is our beautiful friend, Catherine Bernard.
Wonderful introduction, Jack. I'm Catherine Bernard. I'm a criminal defense lawyer. That's a term that sometimes has some stigma associated with it. That's certainly what the prosecutors who have been sending these criminal justice reform bills to us are trying to say, that we're not out for the interests of the people. But I think it's pretty clear from the legislation that Garland just discussed that the ones writing that are the ones who are not interested in the people. We're here on April Fool's Day, and that feels appropriate because a lot of us have been down at the Capitol quite a bit this session, testifying before committees, speaking with our legislators, getting calls and emails from those in our districts and other places, and frankly, we're all tired. We're not getting paid to do this. We don't have taxpayer money to come down here. So frankly, I think this is a great turnout. We've got a lot of folks here who are dedicated and really find it important to make sure we know what's in these laws before they get passed. But it's so appropriate that this is April Fool's Day because that is such a total reversal of what we should be seeing. Bills of this scope and size should be presented to us by the people who are seeking to impose them on us. If HB 310, the governor's signature criminal justice reform package, is such a wonderful thing for all Georgians, Why wasn't it introduced until February 11th of this session? Why wasn't it pre-filed and presented to everyone so that these arguments could have been hashed out previously? I was just sent this morning an article from Danny Porter, the head of the president of the Prosecuting Attorneys Council, stating how disappointed he is at these attacks on the bills that he's supporting. I'm disappointed that this is the first time he's seen fit to publicly comment on it. If he truly is a representative of the people, if these legislators truly are representatives of the people, they need to be presenting us with this information rather than forcing us at our own expense to track down bills as they sneak their way through the House. And Garland did a great job of going over these bills, but I can tell you from the perspective of a criminal defense lawyer that this is such a danger to our core freedoms. One problem I think all of us have had as we talk to our friends and family members about these bills is they think criminal justice reform, well, what does that have to do with me? I'm not a criminal. I'm never going to be part of this system. And that's what's so scary about these bills, is they turn all of us into criminals.
Yeah.
They put all of us one traffic ticket away from tyranny, from being under the thumb of a Department of Community Supervision.
And when frankly, they make us all political dissidents.
Exactly. This is a tool of control that puts us all within the clutches of a tremendously powerful state agency that they're trying to tell us won't cost any additional money or require any new appropriations whatsoever. So this is an issue that affects us all, but it's going to be a challenge for us to get our fellow citizens to be concerned about it. That's why we can connect it with events such as the ones that have been happening around the country and the metro area, in which unarmed individuals defending their own homes, have been brutally murdered by agents of the government. That's the kind of thing that you would expect to hear about in a banana republic, not in a place like the United States of America. And yet every day we turn on the television and there's someone who's gotten tasered to death, someone who's been injured by the very people that we are paying to protect and serve us. Something has gone dangerously wrong, and nowhere is it more clear than in the no-knock search warrant legalization bills, HB 310, and the most dangerous one of all, the one that we still have a chance to do something about, SB 94. So what I'm asking y'all to do today is keep it up for at least one more day. Tomorrow is the last day of the legislative session, and we still have a chance to stop SB 94. This is a bill that would create secret search warrants. This is a bill that would allow search warrants to be obtained by probation officers under the Department of Community Supervision. It turns every principle of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights on its head, and yet it is about to be considered by the Senate. So please contact Charlie Bethel, the gentleman who originally had SB 94, an excellent bill, and has now had the abominable HB 430 tacked onto it. That is the difference that we can make. So I ask you to remember, criminal justice reform isn't just one issue among many. It is the very core of our government's responsibilities. It is at the very core of everything we hold most dear as Americans. John Adams was a criminal defense lawyer. The men who wrote the Bill of Rights were concerned about the rights of defendants, not because they were wanting criminals to get away with things, but because they recognized that the government that has the power to define you as a criminal has the power to take away everything that you hold dear, your life, your liberty, your property. So it is imperative that we stand up against this inversion of American tradition, this allowing the prosecutors and the judges and the politicians to define our rights for us. And we must stand up as the people to do it for ourselves. Thank you. And since we do have a couple of minutes, and we do have this wonderful South Atrium in such a lovely setting, I know this can be a very confusing subject. We have all these different bills going on, so if there's anyone who has any questions, any concerns, I would be happy to take those at this time. As many of you know, I have been practicing criminal law for about 6 years now and have gotten to see the really ugly side of it. The people who agree with us are out there in the courthouses right now. They couldn't get off work. They couldn't get out of court to be here today, but it does not mean that they are not standing with us. So if anyone has any questions, I'm happy to take them. Yes, sir.
Please repeat the question.
I was asked if judges are really as crooked as the other politicians, and I will state that I know many, many great judges. There are some people who really get elevated to that position and really make a sincere effort to justly decide the rights of those who are before them. But unfortunately, judges are being constrained by what the politicians and legislators are doing. They're finding their hands tied. Privately, many judges will admit that the drug war is a failure, that police officers have become entirely too comfortable with dishonesty in the courtroom, that the laws that they are forced to uphold are often found unconstitutional, as in fact the implied consent law was on Friday of this last week. So I won't say that they all are, certainly some of them are, but I'll add one thing. One of the problems with HB 310 is that when you do have a good judge, when you have someone who is interested in accountability and local control, that judge is going to be disempowered under HB 310, because HB 310 centralizes power at the state level. So now the judges will have to be competing with each other to see who's going to get named to be the judicial representative on the Board of Community Supervision. So it's again the trend of centralizing power away from the localities where people can have honest conversations about what they want to see out of their justice system.
And politicize it.
Yes, that absolutely politicizes it. Yes,
I just want to know why the media is not here and why it's been so quiet. Nobody's covered it. If I hadn't been in different groups, I wouldn't even know about this as a citizen. Why? Where is the media? Where are they? That's what I want to know. I know you're a liar, but you can't tell us. Where is our media that's supposed to let us know what they're doing to people?
That is a great question, and I think there's a couple of answers for it. One, I will note that News Radio 106.7 did do some excellent coverage yesterday of the grand jury presentation in Lawrence County regarding David Hooks. Michael Graham, the talk show host, has done some great work exposing this and connecting it with SB 94, which of course includes a provision for full immunity for officers who kill or cause injury while they are executing search warrants. So there are some good ones out there, and we need to keep getting the information to them. We have to remember, our tax dollars are being used to write those press releases about the medical marijuana bill that actually is really just a pro-smuggling bill to get people to get cannabis oil from other states and bring it here in contravention of federal law. So the Religious Freedom Act, again, well-motivated, but it is causing a lot of distractions. So we just need to keep getting the information out within our communities and to the media.
Just want to add one thing to Trisha's question before we go to Bill. So part of the problem with the media coverage is that the part of the problem is that the complexity of the issues. The no-knock search warrant issue was a little bit more straightforward. We got 11 alive to cover that. You've probably seen that, although I think they were the only ones. The media is not really attuned to civil liberty and freedom issues. We're trying as hard as we can to explain it. But when you get into something as tricky as Senate Bill 94 and House Bill 430 substitute, and all of the massive expansion of power in a 4,000-line bill for HB 310, it's really hard to communicate that to the news media. So we're constantly talking, Catherine and I, she's got all the details, and I'm trying to figure out how to summarize this stuff up to where the average news guy can understand it. So we're still working on it, but that's part of the problem.
I would just like to note, for any news guys listening, we think you're all very intelligent. We're just trying to get you the information.
By the way, we do have our own news media here. This is I want to recognize the Liberty News Media movement here. Jan Horn, Ted Betts, and Nydia Tisdale are all covering this event, and they have covered it everywhere we go. They are there. We can always count on them to videotape, but we can't necessarily engage the mainstream media. So thank you so much for all of you. I really appreciate it.
Nevertheless, of the three senators that voted against this bill, 310, have you been in touch with those senators? Have you made any attempt to contact the 20 who chose not to vote? Because because that could be a significant step forward in educating them as well. So please elaborate on that if you could.
Absolutely, and even though the vote reflected at the time of passage of HB 310 in the Senate did reflect 3 no votes, we are informed that Marty Harbin also voted no and reported a no vote with the Secretary of the Senate. So there were actually 4 people, Senator Mike Crane, Senator Josh McCoon, Senator Michael Williams, and Senator Marty Harbin, who all voted no, and we do appreciate their courage in going against it. Unfortunately, the governor has been very powerful in terms of presenting his agenda to the legislature. We think this does create a separation of powers problem, and it puts these individuals in a tough spot. So we are continuing to reach out to them, continuing to support them, and we'd ask that others do the same. Point out that, you know, they're all still here after their no votes, and really they're going to get even more support than ever before on that. So that's a great point. We need to celebrate the ones who do the hard thing, that do the right thing.
I got an email from Mike Scapini, and he told me the people who did not vote are just as guilty as the ones who voted against them. So they're not our friends either.
We have a question in the front.
Yes, please. The Georgia Bar Association was tasked with regulating attorneys' conduct in office in government officials. I've complained to a judge, former magistrate judge, about whether or not I could make an ethical complaint against senior assistant attorney Janet Ray for her recalcitrance in this medical cannabis issue. And I've also had my problems with Chuck Sahos and Danny Porter and their sophistry in how they present these issues to the Georgia legislature. What about making ethical complaints? We're talking about ethics. You said this is an ethical problem, what the Georgia Prosecuting Attorney's Council of Georgia is doing here in their presentations to the legislature. Where is the Georgia Bar Association in regulating the Georgia Prosecuting Attorney's Council of Georgia, please?
I think that's a great question, and I think it is something that more and more members of the bar are starting to recognize as an issue. But we have to remember, this is the beginning of this discussion. This is the first legislative session where these attacks by the prosecutors have been as bold as they have been. So we are at the forefront of this, and what we have to do is keep getting the word out, keep making lawyers feel more comfortable with coming forward, because we have to remember a lot of these lawyers depend for their financial livelihood on being able to practice in front of these judges and get plea deals from these same prosecutors. You know, 95% of cases are resolved with a plea bargain that is exclusively within the control of the prosecutor. So there's a lot of very interconnected financial incentives here that we're working against, and it's going to be a challenge, but I think it's very important for concerned citizens to keep calling out those ethical issues, keep bringing them to the attention of the bar, and I think that's where we're going to have to just keep working on it. This is the new civil rights movement in a lot of ways.
Representative David Staver said, deal drives every decision under the Bill of Bill. Do you disagree with that? And if so, what are we going to do about the governor? It's not our elected officials that are being pressured and offered party positions and special actions and perks if they do what they're told, or threatened if they don't. What do you say about that?
I agree that we have a serious separation of powers problem when the governor is openly not just proposing legislation to the legislature, but insisting that it be passed and that fellow legislators are joining in that insistence. However, I have to remain optimistic about the motivations of people involved. I believe that Governor Deal believes that this criminal justice reform will be a good thing for the people of Georgia, because the people that are on this criminal justice reform council, this is some of the information that they've been getting. This is not the information that we've been seeing from the people in the trenches and the front lines. So I think what we have to keep doing is making sure that we are appreciative of Governor Deal's stated desire for criminal justice reform. The question is, whether the criminal justice reform being proposed actually does what it says it's going to do, make things better and more free for all Georgians. And I think the answer to that is a clear no. So what we have to do is keep up with our educational campaign, keep bringing individuals in who had direct experience with probation, people who have been on these electronic monitoring systems for 18 months without being convicted of any crime, people who have experienced no-knock search warrants, who have been beaten simply for asking to see a warrant before their home was searched. We have to keep bringing these specific, clear, factual examples to the attention of the politicians, and that's something that, again, we're just starting to do. We're just starting to do that, and I'm very hopeful that the governor, as he sees what is actually happening on the ground, will incorporate this into his criminal justice reform for the next go-round.
Not to usurp this press conference, but we have other business with the deal. Last night at midnight, we saw the transportation bill passed. We've seen the Common Core bills passed this year. We have a problem with our executive branch, who is driving every decision under the gold dome.
And I agree, there are many issues, but I will say criminal justice reform underpins everything else. Because even if all the other laws are bad, how will they be enforced? They'll be enforced through the criminal justice system. So this isn't an issue of let's just pick our priorities, because obviously the education system, what is more important than the education of our children? But the way that those will be enforced and the mechanisms of that enforcement, that's what we're dealing with these no-knock search warrants. We've seen SWAT raids on homeschoolers in other parts of the country. We don't want to see that in Georgia. Thank you so much, everyone. This has been wonderful.
Before we close, Nydia, do you want to say anything in closing? Okay, Jack, if you remember, Jack has got these petitions here. They're letters to the governor.
Everybody get one.
We're asking everyone to get one, sign one, and hand one into the governor's office right now. Single file. We walk in with our letter and hand it to the receptionist there. So before we leave, let's make sure we do that. I'm assuming that everything.
First.
Yeah. So let's take care of the governor's office first, and then we can go wherever we need to go after that. They're all in the caucus right now, so we won't be able to get to them.
No, I know, but at least they would know. I mean, their staff would be busy.
Right. That sounds like a good idea. So we might visit Charlie and Golan's office. I don't know how much. I think Golan's going to wait to come, but it might not be there.
I know we have some audience members who are standing up there and watching rather than coming down here with us. And you know, they might say, well, your stack of petitions isn't as big as other stacks of petitions. But I'm asking everyone to consider not what is the popular thing to do, but what is the right thing to do. This is the core of government, the core of our justice system. So please, you know, if you have arguments against us, tell us what those arguments are. Come down, speak to us about it. Whoever you're texting, tell them to come down as well. But we're here for the right reasons. We're here because we want Georgia to be a better, safer, freer place for everyone. And we'd love for you to join us. That's our message for everyone. We'd love for you to join us.
Thank you very much.
One back there, everybody. No matter.
Thank you.
Excellent. My comments. That's great.
My thinking has evolved on medical cannabis. And I know why. Because when I was helping him, I said, come on, you gotta look, there's a lot of money sitting here. He finally said, Greg's right, there's a table full of money we're walking away from here. I saw you guys finally
figured it out. I'll leave you with a quote. Life is a gift. Freedom is a responsibility. That's what we're
doing. I'm glad you're here.
Yes. Enjoy your stay. I'm not enjoying my stay, but that's why we're here, because freedom is a responsibility. And that's why we're here. All they're talking about. And our freedoms are disappearing rapidly.
That's an oligarch. Got billionaires to making those decisions, not the lady behind the desk, that's for sure.
No, it's not that. It's not you.
No, you're getting me signing this.
Find it on the second page there.
Yeah.
Do it at the same time.
Mm-hmm. You can use this against me at a later date, are you?
Your
button,
you never quit.
That's my point about what I was just saying. That's my point about what I was just saying. Wendell Willard, so 2002.
So who? How do we get it? Can you give it to that lady over?
They're giving
that lady.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
My husband and I are
out tonight.
Oh, it'll be a nice night, probably. It's just not going to rain.
Yep. And there's a new phone number. Oh, you know what, Jen? I hope my phone is in my car.
What
do
you think, too?
Well,
They've also hijacked the civil rights movement.
And then they persecute black men. I'm sorry. Is this not the stupidest thing you've ever seen?
Yeah.
It is. That's probably why there were two pins.
And threaten.
And we're just too nice for that.
But we both.
It
doesn't do any good.
She's just, oh, we're just upset about these drills.
It's mine right there. It's my husband's. These are three fellows that had to leave.
That's fine. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hey, Judy.
Hey, Chris. How are you?
How are you?
We're good.
Are you in my
shop? Hello.
Hi.
Thank you.
You're in the
car.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Where are you going? Do you want to go to Charlie Gapol's office?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody else?
Who is
that's
the
criminal.
Did you see the list?
Yes.
This is our map.
Oh my gosh.
See that?
Yeah.
School in Chicago. This is our year.
Is this your charm?
No.
I'll talk to you guys.
Okay.
Oh, is that?
See you, Ms. Lady. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I need to see that. Certainly.
And then I'll sign my slip and then hand it in too. So just.
Oh, so is Nydia, and so is.
No comment.
My guess, that's 45 years ago. It's online, I saw on Facebook. This is
Thank you.